Well, the second stage of the Tour de France is, or Tour de France, depending on how you say it, is underway this morning. We've been through the prologue and the first stage. James Raia, the author of the Tour de France for Dummies book, is joining us this morning to kind of explain it all. And let's start with stages. What does that mean necessarily?
The race usually has 20 stages, and each day it represents a stage. And they also have the confusing thing called the prologue, which kind of sets up all of the stages and determines who gets to wear the yellow jersey, the leader's jersey, for the first stage. And so the race continues for 3 weeks with a couple of rest days and 20 stages.
So the difference then between what happened on Saturday and what happened on Sunday, is it purely jersey, or did the times and stuff actually count too?
And that's where it gets even more confusing. The time actually does count, but it doesn't necessarily count as a stage, and that's the French being the French.
Yeah.
That's how I can explain it.
There's a lot of that.
There's a lot of that. A lot of that in this race, yes.
And stages are different distances.
Absolutely. Mountain stages, flat stages, time trials. It encompasses everything there is to do with cycling except for track racing. So anything that has to do with road cycling is in the Tour de France.
Let's move on to the jerseys. The jerseys are so important. Each day you really hope to be wearing one of the great ones. The wonderful one, of course, is the yellow.
The Maillot Jaune is the yellow jersey, and it designates the leader of the race every day. And then, of course, at the end in Paris, the overall winner of the race. The green jersey is a sprinter's jersey. The fastest guys get that. The best young riders under 25 years old. And the polka dot jersey, named after a candy bar of all things.
Is that really where that comes from?
Yeah, there was a sponsor of the race in the 50s, a candy bar company, and it stuck. And so now the best climber gets the polka dot jersey.
Oh, that's funny.
Yeah.
So what are some of your favorite terms that get tossed around?
Bonjour, bonsoir, comment ça va?
Vino.
And he said his French wasn't all that good.
Well, he knows what he needs to know, I think.
My favorite one, of course, is where's the food?
Yeah.
How's that, how's them?
Well, your peloton, it's the group of the main riders. And during the Tour of California, people in this area really got an interest in cycling because you got to see the big group of riders go whoosh
yes.
as they went by.
Actually, the peloton is the group. It's the French word for a large group. And there's words like gruppetto, which is a small group. And so the peloton really means the main field, the pack of riders, and how they progress on the stage.
Now, we show Domestique, but they do more than carry just the water, don't they?
Domestique is the riders who never get the glory. They ride for riders like Lance Armstrong or Floyd Landis. And they're the guys who, during the day, take their time at the front and help prepare the race leader or the team leaders for his time in the mountains or and just control the group.
One of the great domestiques that we may know for Lance or maybe even Floyd Landis before was George Hincapie.
George is a great guy, very quiet, unassuming guy, and now in his early 30s has kind of come into his own. He actually won a stage 2 years ago and has a good chance to do well this year.
You know, one of the interesting things I think about the Tour de France is that there's so much strategy that goes into it. And really, it's from reading books like this and understanding it. Yeah, that was a freebie. understanding it that you can really, really enjoy it. And it becomes this three-week kind of TV odyssey for, well, people like me because you get so into it.
I think when you look at a bike race and you see 200 guys going down the street, it looks very simple because they make it look so nice and easy. But there's team strategies, and there's always something to watch, and there's always who's going to go to front, who's going to go to the front, or what team's doing what to whom, and it is a team sport. And for a lot of people, it's hard to grasp that concept that it is a team sport.
Are the drugs really killing this race, though?
They are.
Yeah.
They're going to have to do something that's very, very drastic, or I think the sport will implode, and it'll be much less popular.
Does an American stand a chance this year?
Well, as I mentioned earlier, Levi Lipheimer has finished in the top 10 three times. He always usually has one bad day somewhere along the line, and he loses a lot of minutes. But I think this could be the year that he could finish on the podium or the top three.
Yeah.
Who are the guys that we should look to potentially be on the podium at the end of the race?
Andreas Klodin is a Kazakhstan rider who finished as high as third. There's four or five other guys who have been there before on the podium. And there's always the chance that a newcomer will come that people don't know who will take a flyer one day and get a big lead, and they'll say, who's that guy?
Right.
And then they'll have to determine whether they go chase him down or not.
You say France or France?
I say France.
Good for you.
Me too.
All right, and we have, James has a great blog. We'll have that link to KCRA.com later today. Thanks for coming in with all the info today.
Thank you.
We appreciate it.
And the book, again, is Tour de France for Dummies, available, I'm assuming, at local bookstores.
Yes, it is.
Very nice. Thank